Okay, so so what we have done up to now is discover that our problem in a dimension in the Hall space in dimension d plus 1 is equivalent to a problem in dimension d. Let's see, okay, let me erase. So now we are in dimension d. So understanding minimizers of our original problem is equivalent to understand minimizers of, let's see if I have the notation, the following energy. Minimizers of E1 of V, where this is the 1/2 the norm of V H 1/2 square plus the integral of F of V. Now, one can compute the Lagrange equation. So you just say V over D epsilon, epsilon equals 0 of V1 of V plus epsilon, sorry, E1 of U plus epsilon W. You do the derivative, and you get something like, I would say, minus Laplacian 1/2 minus U plus F of U W equals 0, where this is the integral of u of x minus u of y, x minus y, to the d plus 1, dy. So this is the minus Laplacian 1/2 of u of x. Well, you have seen many of these, right? But, so you just differentiate the Lagrange equation, and you integrate by parts in some sense, or you just use the symmetry. And here, F is the derivative of capital F. Right? You do the, when you do U plus epsilon V, you differentiate, you get F of U times V. So these are the Euler-Lagrange equation. So we got an equation as before. The difference is that instead of having the Laplacian, now we have the half Laplacian. And now let's try to make the same analysis as we did before. So assume that F of V is 1 minus V square, square over 4, like in Allen-Kahn. Then if U is a minimizer of E1, then U epsilon of X defined as U of X over epsilon, this is a minimizer of this new energy. Is a minimizer of E epsilon of V, which is, I have to check now the numerology. 1/2 norm of V H1 square plus 1 over 4 epsilon integral 1 minus V square square. Okay, so this energy is not, So it's a minimizer of this energy, in fact. But you see, if I'm a minimizer of this energy, I'm a minimizer of every multiple of this energy. So I can also divide by 1 over log of epsilon in front. I'm also a minimizer of this. And why I do this? Because now, so my U epsilon minimize this energy, and then there is the following theorem. As epsilon tends to 0, E epsilon gamma converge again to the perimeter. Okay? Which means, corollary, U epsilon converge in L1 log to characteristic of E minus characteristic of RD minus E, E local minimizer of perimeter. So classical perimeter, no fractional, anything, right? We're back to the class, to just the same result as before. It's a minimizer of the perimeter. Okay. So once you look at this, then you can just same as the Georgi conjecture should hold. Now, right? So if, because of this analogy, everything I've told you in the last lecture, you can just repeat it, replacing the Laplacian with one half Laplacian. Because anyhow, everything was just motivated by this gamma convergence result, and you still converge to the perimeter, so why not? So you can expect the same result as before to hold. And in fact, there have been some positive answer. So now I can can I erase now the Georgi? We've seen it.
Alessio, actually, you have a whole bunch of fractional Laplacians, right? All the ones with, depending on how you write the exponent, d plus 2s, but...
I'm interested in one half.
No, no, I understand. I understand your interest. Okay, I respect that, but I was just noticing this, right? I mean, in principle, you have... you can say, qualitatively, you can make this remark with a different scaling over there.
Yeah, for every all Laplacian, but then if your Laplacian is between one half and one, you get the perimeter. If the Laplacian is less than one half, you get the fractional perimeter.
Okay, and where you don't have the picture that you, for the minimal surfaces.
You don't have the results on fractional minimal surfaces. Okay. So a priori, you could state this statement for every fractional Laplacian between one half and one included.
Okay, that's what I was saying. Okay.
Yeah. In particular, one half is the borderline case. So as S becomes less than one half, you don't get the perimeter anymore. You get the fractional perimeter. Okay, so let's take the results. So B equal to, there have been a paper by Cabré and Sola Morales in 05. Then D equal 3. Cabré and Cinti in 2010. And then if you go in dimension between 4 and 8, there is a paper by Savin, where in fact what he does is does the result for all, for the fractional Laplacian for every S between 1 half and 1, except 1 half. And then he announced that the case 1 half is doing it. This, in this paper, I do one half between one half and one because it's easier. But now the method I'm doing the also one half. So Savin announced again under the assumption that U, if U tends to plus and minus one, as XD tends to plus and minus infinity. So again, same assumption as for the classical Laplacian, you need to assume that the limit at plus infinity and minus infinity of U is plus and minus one. So in particular, U is a local minimizer. Okay, so this is just the generalization of Savin also for this Laplacian. There are also versions in the fractional case between one half, in fact, of this result. So the only one which is not been written but announced is the one half case because it's the borderline that's a bit more annoying. Okay, let me recall you now that the case, so stable solutions are 1D in RD minus 1, then monotone are 1D in RD, right? I had this discussion that there is this discussion I made before. If you can prove something for stable in some dimension, you get for monotone solution one dimension more. So here I can find a statement. The result we recently proved with Joaquin Serra. So theorem. Serra. So you take, let U from R3 into R be a stable solution of minus Laplacian one half of U equal F of U u less or equal than 1, so use bound, for some f, let's say c0 alpha in R. So some any f which is c0 alpha. Then u is 1D. Okay? So we prove that in dimension 3, stable solutions are always one-dimensional. And in fact, it doesn't even matter what you put as a right-hand side. It doesn't matter that this is Allen-Kahn. Whatever f you put, you get the result. And this is something that was already observed, not for stable, but for the Georgi. So in the classical case by Alberti, Ambrosio, and Chavi, Cabré, in 2001, that this kind of rigidity results, very often they hold, in fact, for every f. So or even if the conjecture is motivated by Allen-Kahn, so you would expect that it's really crucial that the energy is 1 minus v squared over 4. I mean, something that gamma converges to the perimeter. In the end, no matter what f you put, these results seem to be true. So at least the results for the fractional for the classical Laplace in dimension 3 holds for every f, and now we get it for every f also in this case. So remark. So this is the analog of the result for minimal surface in dimension 3, the result I stated by Schoen, Docarmo, Wang. So this is the analog of the result that say that stable surface in dimension 3 are planes. And remark, this is open for the Laplacian. So if here you put Laplacian, the result is open because you see we're doing stable solution dimension 3, corollary, De Giorgi true for d equal 4. Right? Stable dimension 3 implies the monotone dimension 4, which for the classical Laplacian is open. Savin can do it under this extra assumption, but not there is no De Giorgi yet. Okay? So, in the remaining 45 minutes, I will try to give you as many elements as I can of the proof. So now we start to do something a bit more, let's say, maybe interesting on the one end and maybe less elementary and user-friendly. But I will try to emphasize the main ideas. Okay, so we want to prove this theorem. There are three steps that we want to prove for this result. So let me mention the step, and then I will tell you what are the technical tools, and we try so to get the proof. So strategy of proof. So step one consists in proving the following. So you take minus Laplacian 1 half of u plus f of u, or I don't know, yeah, equal f of u, doesn't matter, plus or minus, equal f of u in a Rd, any dimension, u stable. Then, for every r, the integral over Br of grad u, oh my god, is bounded by constant r to the d minus 1 log r, and the double integral over br of u of x minus u of y square x minus y over d plus 1 dx dy is bounded by constant r to the d minus 1 log square r. So this is the integral of the gradient of u in a ball of radius r, and this is the h1 half norm in a ball of radius r, more or less. I mean, it's not exactly this the formula, in fact, but that's what we get. So this is true in every dimension. So the step two, if d d equal 3, we can remove in that estimate a log r. So here you get the same estimate without log, and here you get this estimate with only one log and log, not log square. And actually these are optimal. So if you test these estimates for the 1D solution, you get exactly that growth. So that's the sharp estimate without the log. And then third step, once you have the optimal growth, we prove that U is one dimension. So these are the three key points, and let me start with the proof. Okay, wait, I have to take my notes. I have them here, okay. Let me start with the proof of step one. Let's see what I want to write. Probably I will move there. So there are several things that I need to use. But probably let me start to make some comments. So there is one of the things we use in this step is the following lemma. So on the one end, you have a very natural object appearing in all these quantities, which is the H1 half norm. Okay, the H1 half norm is just there because it's the energy. Then in fact, and this is something that was already discovered previously in the setting of non-local mineral surfaces, when you kind of try to use stability, you can make appear the classical, let's say, L1 norm of the gradient of the solution. So by stability, this will appear. So quantity like this appears from the stability fact. The H1 half norm is there. I mean, we're minimizing that. I mean, we are a critical point of this. And now you want to play with these quantities. And the key point is that these quantities are not the same, but they're very much comparable. How they're comparable, and it's crucial that there is such a result, and the following, so we prove the following lemma. I mean, I don't know, we prove it. I'm not claiming originality, maybe, probably people knew it, but it's the kind of interpolation inequality that are difficult to find usually around. So. Let's say you have a function u bounded by 1, and you assume that the gradient of u is in L infinity, is bounded in L infinity of B2, let's say, is bounded by constant L. Okay, let me call the name, let me change the name. So let v be a function which is bounded by 1 and is Lipschitz in B2 with for some certain constant L0 that is at greater or equal than 2. Number, which is not too small, just because I want to put a log. Then, the norm of V in H1 half of B1 square is bounded by constant log L0, 1 plus the integral over B2 of the gradient of V. So this inequality is telling you that, okay, this norm, the norm of the gradient, cannot control the H1 half norm, but it can do it if you put a logarithm of the Lipschitz constant. And here, the key point here in this inequality that is gonna save us is that first of all, we get log here. It's not, so if you put log square and you repeat our proof, it doesn't work. So it's a little log to the power 1. And here we have a power 2. This quantity is a square, is a double integral, I mean, it's quadratic in V, while this is linear in V. And that's also something that is gonna help us in a crucial way. I will not prove these inequalities. I mean, the proof is not super complicated, but you need to play a bit with some Fourier. This is a general lemma. Given any function bounded by 1, Lipschitz constant bounded by L, the H1 half norm is controlled by the BV norm, the integral grad. Let me try to convince you just. Let's try to make an example. I think it's more instructive. So, and you see why the log. So what is, let's do one dimension. So example. I mean, it's a course, so. Let's think of this case. V, so I am in an interval, let's say minus 1, 1. And this is my v. So it's 0 here and 1 here. Okay, so I have a function which jumps. Then, well, what is v prime? V prime, in the sense of distribution, is a delta, Dirac delta, the function jumps. So v prime is the delta 0. And the integral of v prime is 1, is the mass of the delta, which is 1. Okay. Now, what is the H1 half norm? So the H1 half norm, it means that you have to do the integral from minus 1 to 1, integral from minus 1 to 1, of v of x minus v of y square x minus y. We are in dimension 1, so it's square. Okay? Now, v, this function, is either 1 or is 0. So if x is here and y is here, so in this interval, you see this is 1, and then you get 0. If x and y are both here, you get 0 again. So the only interesting case is when, let's say, x is here and y is here, because then you get something, you get non-zero here. So this is essentially up to a factor 2. This is the integral where you take y in minus 1 from 0, and then you take x, so dy, and then you take x from 0 to 1. Maybe you put a 2 because you have to count it twice. And then the numerator is always 1, and the denominator is x minus y to the power 2. Okay? So now you have a point y here. You integrate 1 from 0 to 1 in the x, this integral. This is something like 1 over y. Right? The primitive is 1 over y. Evaluated at 0 and at 1. 1 gives you a bounded term. It doesn't matter. The problem is the singular. So this is a term which is singular with x and y are very close. So the problem is the term when you evaluate at 0. So it's something like this. But then you see you have the integral. So this is something like the integral from minus 1 to 0 in dy, or 1 over modulus of y, and this is plus infinity. So it's not true that if this is bounded, this is not bounded. Right? This. But then you say, okay, but this function is not Lipschitz. Now let's try to make it Lipschitz. So then the second case is this up to 0. Then you take epsilon, you go. So this is 1. And you make a function which transition, let's say, in a length epsilon. Now this is my v, new v. Okay, and then you say, let's repeat the computation. Okay, let me erase maybe this, not so important. Okay, then you do the cases. So you have x here, y here, x here, y here, x here, y here, x here, y here. I mean, all the possible cases. So let's say I have the integral, for instance, from there are many pieces, but essentially these are of this form. Either x, so x is here. So this is epsilon 1. So integral from epsilon to 1, dx, and the integral from minus 1 to 0 dy. Then I have integral from 0 to epsilon dx, so x is here, and y is still negative, minus 1 to 0 dy. Then I may have both x and y this interval, so integral from 0 to epsilon dx, integral from 0 to epsilon dy. And then you can have maybe dx here and y here, but they're all symmetric. Integral from 0 to dx, integral from epsilon to 1 dy. And then you exchange all the variables. Okay, let's try to understand the argument now. So the integrand we have to put here is v of x minus v of y square divided by x minus y square. And now we have to look what is the numerator depending where the pieces are. So in the first case, x is here, y is here, the numerator is 1. This is 1 and this is 0. 1 squared is 1. So we get 1 over x minus y square. Okay? Now the integral of this is 1 over x, as before, the first integral. That's the primitive, evaluated at 0 and minus 1. Again, minus 1 is bounded. And then you integrate 1 over x So this is like integral from epsilon to 1 of dx over x, which is log epsilon. What about the second one? So here x is here and y is here. So y is 0, and at x, so at the denominator I have x minus y squared, and the numerator I have 0 here, and here I have the function here is x over epsilon. Is a function which grows with slope epsilon. So that's x over epsilon. So I get x over epsilon squared, the numerator. And now what you get? You get, So you get the integral from 0 to epsilon. So x over epsilon goes out. I have again this integral, which gives you 1 over x. So you get x over epsilon squared times 1 over x from the integral of this. This gives you 1 over x. Okay, x over epsilon over x gives you x. So this is 1 over epsilon squared, integral from 0 to epsilon of x. The primitive is epsilon squared, epsilon squared, epsilon squared, 1. So it's bounded. What about here? So here, you are both inside. So you get x over epsilon minus y over epsilon in this interval, divided by x minus epsilon y squared. In this case, the 1 over epsilon squared pops out. So this is 1 over epsilon squared. Then you have the integral from 0 to epsilon, dx, integral from 0 to epsilon, dy. And now you see that x minus y squared divided by x minus y squared is 1. So you just have 1. And so now you have 1 over epsilon squared, epsilon, epsilon is 1. Again, last one, what is 0 epsilon, and that is another 1. You can check it. In the end, what we got, the singular term is this one, is log epsilon, and epsilon is exactly the Lipschitz constant of V. This function is Lipschitz constant bounded by V. So this is coherent with this. So this example shows that such an inequality is not observed, and then proving it, you need to work. it was kind of, okay, I must say it was a luckiness that I needed a similar inequality like 3 years ago for something completely different. Not this one, but similar. Another interpolation inequality between the H1 half norm of a function and some kind of BV norm. But it was different. It was how in that case, it was how the H1 half norm changes when you take a function like this, any function, and you apply the heat semigroup. You start to regularize with the heat, and you look at how the H1 half norm grows. So there you do it, and you get some log. So then I say, okay. Of course, in that case, in fact, we use that lemma combined with another lemma, and we put it together, and we get that. So. But okay, I mean, you believe that the result is true, then the point is to prove the proof. We do it essentially in Fourier, most of it. Maybe we'll spankare once. Okay, so this is a lemma, I will not prove it, I just wanted to convince you that the result is reasonable. Let's see what I want to convince you of this first step. We do in this following way. Okay. Remark. So we know that U is bounded, and the Laplacian 1/2 of U is equal to F of U. Okay. In the world, R D, let's say. We are in R D, doesn't matter where you are. So here you have to use some elliptic regularity. You say, okay, U is bounded implies that F of U is bounded. Is bounded, okay? So you look at this and you say, okay, but if this is bounded, the fractional Laplacian is bounded. But the fractional Laplacian, you see, the Laplacian are 2 derivatives. And then you take 1/2 of them. So 2 derivatives divided by 2 is 1 derivative. So here you're saying essentially that 1 derivative of U is bounded, which means almost Lipschitz. almost because in elliptic reality you always miss some case endpoints. So this doesn't imply Lipschitz, but it implies that U is a C0 beta for every beta less than one. So you are order continuous, you don't gain one full derivative. But then you go and you say, okay, but now U is C0 beta, F is C0 alpha, so F composed with U now is C 0 alpha times beta. If you compose an order function with another order function, it's still order with the product of the spoiler. But this is, again, minus Laplace and 1 alpha of U. And you say, okay, this is now C0 alpha beta. So now I gain one derivative with respect to this. And now I get that U is C1 alpha beta, which now is Lipschitz, because U is C1, in particular, is van de Graaff. So in particular, the gradient of U is L infinity, belong to L infinity in the whole space. Because I have the equation in the whole space, I can apply this in every ball, so I get. So just by using twice the equation, I got now that I have a universal a priori estimate. My function is Lipschitz globally, okay? So this implies, let's say, that gradient of U is bounded by constant C. Okay, so now I need to start to use stability. So I will try to discuss, if I have time, I will try to discuss better the stability, how it works. But since it's a bit technical, let's see if first try if I can conclude all the steps, and I will give you for granted some technical computation. So when you have a stability, so this is a general principle. You know that your function is a solution, you know this is stable. Stable means when you do the second variation, you get an inequality. And now everything, all the proofs that use stability, now you have to be lucky. You have to find the right test function. So you have to decide, okay, I know that differentiating along some direction, I get an inequality. Which function I have to take? Along which direction I have to differentiate? You have to try and guess it. I mean, there is no recipe. I must be honest with you. I mean, there is no universal way. In our case, we're again motivated by some results on fractional mineral surfaces and previous results, for instance, by Enrico and Ovidio, Savi. We just said, okay, let's try to see if we can get all the bounds we need by essentially you take your solution and you compare it with a translation of itself. Of course, you cannot just translate everything because you are not allowed. I mean, it's like you take an hyperplane, you translate it, you don't see anything because you translate an hyperplane, you see an hyperplane. You're only allowed to do perturbations which are compactly supported. So what you do is not translating everything. You just so you take your guy in a ball of reduced R, and what you see there, you translate it a bit, and then you put a cutoff function to make sure that you keep the same boundary data. But inside, essentially, you take your guy and you start to translate, and you see what happens. So, we are going to start. So, proof of step one. So now let W be a stable solution in B2. I don't call it U because this, I'm not going to apply this to U. I mean, I'm going to apply later this, but not to U, to a rescaling of U. So I take, let U be a stable solution of my equation in B2. I only need it in a ball. Okay, now stable means, so I know, this means that if I take for any variation V epsilon such that V0 equals VW, so you take one parameter variation with respect to epsilon, you know that d square over d epsilon square, epsilon equals 0, of the energy of W epsilon is non-negative, right? Where we said E1, remember, of V is the H1 half norm plus the integral of F of V, where F is the primitive of little f. So what variation we take, we consider W epsilon to be W composed with this psi epsilon V inverse, where psi, I define for you psi epsilon V of a function. So I need to define you this function. So you take a point x, and you do x plus epsilon V times a cutoff function. So V times phi of x, where phi is a cutoff. So phi, let's say, is a function like this. So this is B2, this is B1, this is my phi, so phi equal 1 in B1, and phi equal 0 outside B2. So you have this function. See, the function, this is, this function is 0 outside B2, so I'm not doing anything outside B2. And inside B1, this is 1, so I'm moving the point x by epsilon v, so I'm moving the point. So V here, oh, sorry, yes, V is a bad notation, because, sorry, yeah, thank you. Let's call it sigma. Sorry, yeah, sigma here is an element, yeah, because in the paper you use bold, we use bold V, right? That is not a function. I cannot do it bold. In direction is SD minus 1. So you move in at some direction, you do this, and you plug here this in the formula, and you compute the stability. Out of the stability, you have to work a bit, but this is the inequality you get. So out of this, you work, you get the following inequality. Integral over B1/2 of grad W is bounded by constant 1 plus the norm of W in H1/2 of B1, and that's it. Yeah. So this is a computation. You plug in, you work a few pages, and that's exactly what you get. But now, you see here, so in fact, now that you see this, you understand why I wanted to do an interpolation, because here, I have two quantities that are very much similar to each other. So if I could relate them, it would be nice. But in fact, that interpolation is fantastic, because not only allows me to remove H1/2 and reput a gradient, but notice H1/2 has a square, and the gradient doesn't. So if I apply here, okay, so now this is from stability. Now I say, okay, apply the interpolation. What do I get? I get constant, and then this square root, I can replace it by, so the 1 doesn't play much of a role, but I get 1 plus the square root, because here is power is 1 and there is 2, log of the Lipschitz norm, so let's call it M, times the integral over B2 of grad W. I throw away the first term because, I mean, you can absorb it easily. I mean, I just use the inequality in this simpler form just to avoid having too many terms. There is an extra constant, doesn't matter, okay? So just doing this way, I use this inequality, so this is less than this, and then I remove. Technically, I should keep an extra term, but that's easy. Just I don't want, so I'm gonna cheat a bit sometimes just to simplify the expressions, but here you use interpolation. Now you see the beauty, because I control this quantity with the square root of itself. Okay, so now you just use the usual trick. When you have a product, A times B is bounded by delta A plus 1 over delta B. So for every constant A and B, the square root of AB is bounded by A times delta plus 1 over delta times B. For every delta. So here I apply this, I get constant, square root, the square root disappears, I get log M, and this I apply with the delta denominator, plus constant delta, integral over B2 of grad W. I said it, but I didn't write. M equal the L infinity norm of the grad of W. Is that constant? Okay, so this is for every stable solution in B2. I have this inequality. Now I say, okay, here, you see, a priori, what you would like to say is that, okay, take delta small enough so that this constant is less than 1/2, And then you are saying, okay, a quantity is controlled by something plus one half of itself. And then you say, fantastic, because then I can reabsorb it. The only problem is that here you have B one half, and here I have B two. It's not the same ball. I have a larger ball. So you have to work a bit to reabsorb it. But okay, that's not the crucial. So there, you need a covering argument. So you don't. It's not enough to apply this inequality in one ball. You have to apply it in many balls and cover around. So it's a technique which is a bit standard in some sense. Once you know that a quantity is controlled by a small fraction of itself, even if it's a larger ball, you can do it. So by a covering argument, what you get is that the integral over b1 half in the end of grad w is controlled by a constant log m, where m is the Lipschitz constant. So log of grad w, then infinity. Okay, and now what you do, I have to choose to what apply. So just apply these to the function w of x equal u of rx. So you take your solution and you stretch it. And you apply this inequality. What do you get? You get that the integral over b1 half of grad w, so grad w is, when you take the gradient of w, this is the gradient of u rx. So you get the gradient of u rx. But then by chain rule, the gradient, you get an r in front, dx. And this is bounded by a constant, and then the log of the L-infinity norm of the norm of w. But what is the gradient of w? This is r, so grad w at x. Oh. Grad w x is r grad u at rx. And now remember, u is bounded, has bounded the gradient. This term, this is bounded. So this is a constant, I have an r, so I get log r. And now you just do a change of variable, you call this y, and you do change of variable, this becomes the integral of grad u over b r over 2. Dy, and you get 1 over r to the m minus 1 in front. D minus 1, we didn't mention. D is the dimension. Because you get r to the d from the Jacobian, and there was an extra r here to cancel, and you get minus 1. So this is exactly the first statement I said. The integral of the gradient of u in a ball of radius r, or r over 2, where, goes like r to the d minus 1 plus a log. Times log. And once you have this, for the h1 alpha, you just plug it here. Once you have the bound on this, right, you just repeat this. So you know this, right? But then you can just take this inequality and combine it with this inequality to get a bound. So this implies, right, by interpolation, also that the norm of w in h1 alpha of b1 square, or maybe b1 fourth, okay. Right, so if here you have b1, here you get b2. So since here I have b1 half, so here b1 half, I have to do a b1 fourth. Okay. b1 fourth is bounded by constant log of grad w, and then I have another log, so square. A log there and another log from the lemma. And then you just reapply that, and you get the other bound. So this is step one. Okay. Now, how do we improve this? To improve step one, we need, so to, so maybe let me make a remark. Remark. This is suboptimal, something I already said, by a log. Because, so imagine that your solution is 1D. So if I knew that u is 1D, Then I have a function that does something like this. It's equal to minus 1 here, let's say, very close. Then there is a fixed region of width, let's say 1, where it transitions. And then here, it goes to 1. So this is my u. At 1D solution goes from minus 1, then in some fixed amount of time, it goes to almost 1, and then it goes. OK, so if you have a function like this, which is essentially constant here, and then it transitions here, and then you take a huge ball of radius r, what is the, how much gradient this has, u? Here there is no gradient in this part, because u is close to 1. Here there is no gradient, all the gradient is in this band. So here is a slab in Rd. So this is like 1 cross the other directions. So this region is where the gradient lives, is bounded. So you see the integral over Br of grad u is essentially the integral in this slab, let me call it sigma. It's like the integral over sigma intersection Br of grad u is bounded, constant. And the measure of this, so you have a, let's say this is like these are two parallel hyperplanes at distance 1, you intersect with a ball, the measure of this is r to the d minus 1, or larger. You're intersecting a ball with with the set containing two parallel hyperplanes. So for 1D solution, you want this. At the moment, we have an extra log. So it's not optimal what we put. What we do now is that we do, oh, I shouldn't erase this. Okay, well. Now we do step 2. We choose a second test function, W epsilon, here in the variation. And W epsilon here is something like this. So it's, again, W epsilon of x is W compose, sorry, now I can do it with you. U epsilon, I do it with, right with you. I will do it with your scale, so no. So you assume that W is a stable solution. We're going to apply this as before to u over x, like there, right? You take w as u over x later. So you have w, you do the variation, you do w composed with psi, what was it, epsilon sigma minus 1 of x. And what is psi epsilon sigma of x? This is x plus epsilon sigma psi tilde, if you want, of x. Psi of x, phi tilde of x, before it was phi. So phi before was a function which was 1 in b1 and 0 outside b2. Now psi tilde, we take it like this. We go from r to r over 2, this time. Here is r over 2. So phi tilde equal 1 here. And then here, phi tilde is 2 minus 2 log mod of x over log r. So this is what is called a logarithmic cutoff. So to go from r to r over 2, we don't go it linearly. We go using a log. And this is sometimes useful because it makes you gain a log. So instead of using the obvious way of going from, so usually the cutoff function from r over 2 to r, you just say, OK, let me draw a straight line. Right? I just cut it directly, like this, tuck. Instead, if you use a log like this, you gain an extra log sometimes in some estimates. So this is called a logarithmic cutoff. So you do a cutoff using the log. It works slightly better. So you plug in here. And now you get this inequality. So you have to compute again what the stability tells you. You are going to get formulas of this type. So before, the stability told me that the gradient in some ball was controlled by the gradient in some other ball. We had this relation between the integral of the gradient. Here, using an interpolation, I tell you what we get. We get something, a different inequality. So by stability plus interpolation, I mean that lemma again, We get that the norm of W in H1 half of B1 fourth, so in a ball square, divided, sorry, just one thing. I noted there the scaling. No, I didn't note. Yeah. So for every R, I have the following information, that this divided by log R, so R is the scaling I use, is the comes from the cutoff. I can choose R as I want. Is bounded by constant 1 plus square root 1 over k sum j from 1 to k on norm of w h1 half of b2 to the k plus j. And this is a bit scary, I know. Square. Divided by k 2 2 to the k plus j. Yeah. Where, what is k? So here I choose r is 2 to the k in this inequality. So for every r, so fix k, take r 2 to the k, then you can prove such an inequality. You look at it and say, wow, okay. What are you doing? It looks a bit strange, right? It's an inequality. And this is true in every dimension, okay? Now I apply this inequality, so set again, W of X equal U over X, good. And then you plug this inside, and you look what does it tell you on U. And it's only for dimension three that you get a meaningful relation. So this inequality is true in every dimension, but when dimension in three, I mean, when you, so you apply the inequality and then things scale. So you get power of the dimension plopping out. It's like here, right? When you take an inequality and you rescale, you have r to the d minus 1 appearing, right? So there's going to be power of the dimension appearing. And if the dimension is 3, things go well. If the dimension is higher, you get powers that you don't control. But if d is 3, you get this. D equal 3, set the following formula. Aj is the norm of u in h1 half square in b, the ball of the radius 2 to the 2 to j, divided by what? So I look at the ball in a dyadic ball, so in a very large ball, and my goal is to prove that this grows like r to the d, so I want to prove that this quantity grows like r square, we are in dimension 3, times log, not log square, right? I say that I have to gain a log. So I need to say that this divided by the radius square, so 2 to the 2j square, times the log of this, which is 2j, is bounded. So this is the quantity I want to prove to be bounded, right? Energy in a ball, so if you call this is r, r square, log r. I want to prove the optimal growth. So this is the quantity I want to control. And now I check, where it is, what happens, that's what I want, what does it tell me there? This is the inequality you get. For every j, aj is bounded by a constant, 1 plus square root, I mean, you play a bit with that quantity first, but it's not sum, j, let's say, l from 1 to 2k, a k plus l. So that's the inequality. I mean, this is just algebraic manipulations. Okay? It's not super obvious because you have to see the scaling inside. It's only for dimension 3 that you get such a nice relation. So it's only for 3 where no other power appears. You only get A appearing everywhere and there is no thing. Now you say, what do I do with that? So this is my only information. But recall the lemma. Recall that the lemma tells me that the norm of U in H1 half of a ball of radius R is bounded by a constant R square log square r. So this means, in terms of j, log square. Ah, yes, log square, of course. Thanks. Which means that in terms of j, aj is bounded by constant j, right? Because here I have r square log, so I have an extra log there, which tells me that the aj grows linearly. My goal is to prove that aj is bounded, okay? Okay, now you look at this and say, I don't know how to do it, but let me simplify. So I claim that out of this, so if you get a function So if you have a sequence of numbers, aj, which satisfy this inequality, and are grow almost linearly, then they are bounded. There are no there is no way. They must be bounded. And to understand this, let's do a simple case. Let's remove the one in this inequality. Suppose that I have an inequality without a one. It's just there, but it's not important. And let's assume that here, instead of having a sum, I can put, so you see, this is an average. So what is telling me this inequality? It's telling me that the energy in some ball of radius 2 to 2k is controlled by the square root of an average of a, so here I have a sum of 2k terms, but divided by 1 over 2k. So this is a mean, right? So this is a mean. Let's assume the simple case. Aj, sorry, this is a k. Yeah, doesn't make sense. For every k, I have this, yeah, otherwise. So simple case, ak bounded by constant, I forget the one, and instead of having an average, let's say that I only have one of these terms. Let's say the largest one, or any, let's say L equal from 1 to 2k, the largest one is L equal 2k, k plus 2k, 3k. A of 3k. It's one of the terms appearing in this sum. Here I have an average. And then you have a square root. Okay, you have an inequality like this. Okay? Now, I claim that this function must be bounded. It cannot grow sublinear. I mean, if it's sublinear, if it's more linear, then it's bounded. Why? Assume that you have a sequence of points with that. Then you say, okay, I assume that, let's say, there exists a J. So fix M, huge. Fix a very large M to be chosen. And assume that there exists a certain j such that aj is larger than m. I want to prove that there is a contradiction if m is large enough. This will prove for me that then aj is less than m for every j. So assume that there exists such a j. Then what I have is that m over constant, so let's call this constant c0 just to remember that it's this, m over c0 is bounded by ak, sorry, aj over c0. And this is bounded by square root OA3j. Right? This is what is true for every k. So assume that there is some moment where I go. So I discover, so if I have this inequality, you can square this. You discover that a of 3j is larger than m square over c square. And if so if m is large enough, this is c0, this is gonna be, let's say, much larger than m, because we have m squared. Okay, so it has grown. Now, let's reapply it. Then I say, okay, then I apply this inequality with 3. So I get m squared over c0 squared, 1 over c0, is bounded by a3j over c0. So I just, this inequality. But then apply that inequality. This is bounded by square root of a of 3 of 3, not 9, j. So when you take the square, you get a of 9j is greater than the square. So you get m to the 4 divided by c0 to the 6. Then you keep doing that. You get a to the 3 to the m, j, is larger, and you have to look what you get. You get m, let's see, this is gonna be the linear one, so you have to get an m to a power super linear. So you get, said you go, okay, let me look at the paper because otherwise I won't remember. I mean, this is the simple case, right, when you don't have the one, so in the paper we get probably slightly worse. But it grows essentially, it's like m, 2 to the m, divided by c, more or less 2 to the m plus 1. Doesn't matter. But m is much larger than c. So you can make this, so m over c is large. So this is essentially greater than a constant, I don't know, theta greater than 1 to the 2 to the power m, where theta is greater than 1. So this term grows like theta greater than 1 to the 2 to the m, so it's super exponential in m. While a of 3 to the mj by this growth is bounded by constant 3 to the mj. So you see that for m large, there is a contradiction. I have the log information told me that at the most the function grows linearly in j, so in this dyadic scale I get exponential growth, and but iterating the inequality, I get a super exponential. So this is the contradiction. So absurd for m large enough. So the contradiction was, if I can find a point, a j, for which I'm larger than a critical m, m has to be large enough to kill this c0 around, the constant, then you start to grow super exponentially because of this inequality. This large means this much large, then you apply this with 3k, it's much, much, much larger, and then it's growing super fast. Absurd, it must be bounded. So awesome, we gained the extra log. We don't have it. So now the corollary is that this is bounded. Or equivalently, we gain the extra log in dimension 3. And now I close. Just tell you how you close. It's another test function, a third test function. If you plug a third test function here, I just tell you, and you can check on the paper. Which is essentially, instead of a log, you do a log-log cutoff, something that goes super slowly. You plug inside, and you get this information. Instead of these estimates for you, you get the integral over b1 half of the derivative of u, the partial derivative of u, positive part, times the integral over b1 half, partial derivative of u, negative part, is bounded by constant over log log r for every r, and then you get r goes to infinity, you get zero. So what you discover by stability with another cutoff is that in every ball, you take a direction, sorry, not v, sigma. In every ball, you fix a direction, and either the partial derivative in one direction or the partial derivative in the other direction must be positive. This, in every ball, either the positive part or the negative part are always zero. And the only way a function can do that is if it is 1D. Because in every ball, it means that you cannot change sign. You cannot have a bit of positive in one direction. So you see that that is compatible only if the level sets are one-dimensional. And this is true in every ball. I mean, B1 half is every ball. So once you have this in B1 half, this is zero, you move it, the ball around. This is true in the whole space, and a function for which in every point, either in every ball, either all this is zero or all this is zero means it's 1D. And once you have that, you are done. Okay, I think that was enough. Thanks for your attention.